Well, hello, 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 and welcome once again to 25 O'Clock. I'm your host, Dan Drago. Thanks for being here. Thanks for joining me on the show. Here we are, Philadelphia's longest-running music podcast, I believe. Really, really great show this week. Got to talk to Chelsea Mitchell and also bassist Josh Matches of the band Dirty Dollhouse. Great, great conversation. I literally just did it yesterday. It's Monday right now, and I was up recording with Chelsea and Josh last night on Sunday. Came home, edited the whole darn thing, and here we are, Monday morning, and I'm getting it together. It'll be Tuesday when you hear this. But yeah, in case you were interested in the very careful timeline of how episodes come to fruition, there you are. All the information you need right there. We'll talk more about Chelsea, talk more about Dirty Dollhouse in just a moment. But as always, if you're new to the show, old to the show, medium to the show, I highly recommend check out 25oclockpod.com. That's the place out there on the internet, and it's all there. All the episodes available for streaming and for downloading. You can get them all. You can check out the email list and sign up for it. You can check it out and sign up for it. I send out an email every time there's a new episode, let you know what's going on. You can, of course, hook up with us on the socials. We're on Instagram. We're on TikTok. We're out there in the world. I've got a Substack. You can find me on Facebook if you know me. I still don't know how to turn the 25 O'Clock Facebook page back on in a way that makes it seen by anyone without paying for it. That's a very roundabout and strange way of saying I don't want to deal with it unless people can see it. And of course, you want to check out the Friends and Neighbors page. I link anyone and everyone who's ever been on the show. So if you like an artist, you like what you hear, and you want to support them, go to the Friends and Neighbors page, click on the episode link, and it takes you right there. And then you can get to know that artist, sign up for their mailing list, buy their records, find out when they're playing, all that stuff. You can do it all at 25oclockpod.com. And of course, I've been talking about this for a while. I'm getting to the end right here where I'm getting ready to send all the proceeds from Wanna Play a Song Live on 25 O'Clock Volume 1. I'm getting ready to send the proceeds from that to Philly Music Fest very, very shortly. So if you haven't gotten in on it before, now's your chance. Get in on it now. Go to Bandcamp 25 O'Clock pod.bandcamp.com or just check out the show notes or go to the website. I've got links everywhere for that. But you can check out the compilation that I made of 10 performances from the show over the last many, many years, and all the proceeds going to support the charitable giving of Philly Music Fest. Philly Music Fest is a not-for-profit music festival that went off this year in late October. It was outstanding. It was a great festival. They raised a bunch of money, and they're going to give it to all the Philadelphia music charities that they support. Music education, very important. Got to educate the next generation of artists here in Philadelphia, and that's what they do. So if you want to support PMF and get a very, very cool compilation in the meantime, go to the Bandcamp, get the comp, check out the music. It's a lot of fun. I had a great time putting it together, and I hope you all enjoy it. Yes. All right. Now, before we get into the meat of the episode of Chelsea and Josh and Dirty Dollhouse and the new record called The End, which is outstanding, by the way, of course, anyone with a mouthpiece right now is sounding off about the 2024 election results, and it would be odd if I didn't mention it. Don't you know? It would be odd if we just kind of like passed through it and I'm just like, Geyer's on the show this week. What are we all talking about? La, la, la. Even though I've definitely struggled with how to talk about it and what to say to everyone, as if everyone was sitting around waiting to find out, you know, what I wanted to say. But here goes anyway. I'm, of course, filled with massive disappointment, sorrow, fear and empathy for people around me, for people who are going to be very, very directly affected by the results of the election, by the results of a majority of the country voting for whatever the fuck that is, and whatever the fuck it is about to go down in this country over the next 4 years and perpetually forward. People seem to think this stuff just lives in 4 8-year cycles, but I will tell you, as a child of the 80s and the 90s, who became an adult in the late 90s into the early aughts, we were still reaping the benefits of Reagan's United States well after his presidency and even after his death. So don't think just because an election cycle closes that, oh, well, it's all better now or it can all be better going forward. I'm not trying to be pessimistic right there. I'm just simply telling you at least how I've experienced it and how I came up. We were still dealing with the ramifications of 8 years of Reagan well after. But yeah, I'm also full of disgust. Disgust that as a nation, we're going to only give a shit about the economy and what it means to us. And not even the economy, but our perceptions of economy, which are ignorant at best and willfully wrong at worst. I can't even begin to describe my disgust with that right now. The fact that a majority of America looked around, weighed the pros and cons of demagoguery, of potential authoritarianism, and said, well, you know, prices. And also my disgust runs deeper than that. It runs deep to the fact that like day-to-day American life for pretty much all of us who live in this country is basically boiled down to the idea that we are all one to several catastrophic events away from absolute financial ruin and poverty as people. That's simply what existing in this country is right now. A bad week, a bad day, a bad month, a bad year, and suddenly, you know, you're on your own, you're out there, and everyone is so incredibly afraid of that, and rightly so, that seems to be what dictates how we choose our elected officials going forward. It saddens me and disgusts me greatly that literally everyone's choices seem to be boiled down to something as simple and self-serving as that. But I have to, this is the part I wrote down in my notes, turn it around, bring positivity to this. And I'm trying to right here. I really am. But I just want everyone to know on this show and everyone who's been on this show and everyone who listens to this show and anyone even remotely adjacently impacted by this show, I'm here for you all. I support you all. This is a show for everyone. This is a show that includes everyone, and everyone's voice is welcome on this show. Anyone can reach out to me and want to be on the show. And if you're an artist, a musician, or music adjacent out there, we're a big tent here at 25 o'clock, and we're a tent for everyone. It seems at times like this, almost, you know, shallow and flighty and escapist to be like, oh, well, we should embrace art and music and all that. But I honestly think that there's nothing more important than embracing things like that right now, to embrace the potential that human beings have to make beautiful things, especially in times when it seems that all people have is the potential to destroy and make bad decisions and leave the control over to people who don't care about you and don't care if you live or die and don't care what happens to you at all. I think it's important in those moments to embrace the positivity of art, the positivity of music, the positivity of any beautiful creation that human beings can make. I think it keeps us sane. So continue to support. And not support. I'm not even talking about financial support. I'm not even talking about monetary, you know, support. I'm just talking about bring these things into your mind, into your heart, into your lives. Continue to bring these things in. Art, music, things from places that you've never been, things made by people that aren't you, that aren't like you. Continue to do that. I think that's the only way that this goes forward and works. Before I grew into the world and traveled the world and got to know more about the world in even my very, very small way, I mean, I had great teachers about the world, and those teachers were artists, you know, musicians like Fela Kuti and Joe Strummer and Manu Chao, and you've got filmmakers like Costa Gavras and Godard and all the other great international filmmakers that I studied in college and learned more about the world before I would even venture out into the world. And I think of, you know, painters like Frida Kahlo and Basquiat and writers like Kurt Vonnegut and Thomas Pynchon and Joan Didion and all these people that like helped shape what I would think about the world, what I would experience in the world, how I would go about thinking about the world, and all at a time when I, you know, hadn't done any of those things yet. This is a long and rambling way of saying don't close it off. Don't shut down. Don't just go in for the escapist junk food comfort art that exists out there, because a lot of it exists, and there's nothing wrong with dining at that particular table from time to time, but you can't live there. It's not real. And it's important just to move forward and be there for each other and listen to each other. And yeah, that's about what I got. I don't know if that helps or not. I don't know if it helps me. I take no comfort in the idea that I am shortly leaving the United States for a short period of time, moving to another country. I take no comfort in that. People have come up to me and said, well, you know, at least you're getting out, at least you're leaving. I find that to be pretty callous way of thinking about things, a pretty craven way of thinking about things. I take no real joy or solace in where I will physically be located. Because no matter where you go, if you're from here, if you grew up here, if America is your home, you will watch from afar or up close. You will watch what happens. And I'm sure I will have many instances of feelings of powerlessness, rage and anger and sadness and all those things as I bear witness to the next few years of this country and the trajectory that it seems to be that we want to go forward in. I take no solace. I take no comfort in leaving. I will miss you all very much. And aside from just the general sorrow and sadness of missing people that you know and love, I will have this whole other level as well. So it's important that we're there for each other. It's important that we hold each other up. It's important that we continue to share art and music with each other. And yeah, that's where I am with that. So thank you. Thank you all for hearing me out on that. If you fast forwarded through that, I absolutely do not blame you. Anyway, let's talk about the show. Sorry, Chelsea and Josh from Dirty Dollhouse, for me plunking you at the end of that long rambling monologue. But let's talk about the show. Let's talk about the artists. Let's talk about Dirty Dollhouse. Chelsea Mitchell and Josh Matches. I went up to Newtown Book and Record Exchange, which is the book and record store that Chelsea owns. It's up in Newtown, 102 South State Street in Newtown, PA. That is a plug right there. And it was great. We sat down and talked. You'll hear at the beginning of the episode, we're kind of talking, I mean, obviously we're talking about the election, we're talking about the week before. We were originally scheduled to have the interview on the day after, the Wednesday after the election, and obviously we did not do it that day because it would not have been useful for either of us to have done that. But it was great to go up and see the shop and talk to Chelsea and Josh. The new Dirty Dollhouse record, The End, is out right now. Everywhere you get digital music, go to dirtydollhousemusic.com for all of that. And they have a release show coming up November 22nd at Johnny Brenda's with Dominie, who I haven't seen in ages, and Bren, an amazing singer-songwriter from Bethlehem, PA. I saw her open up for Brittany Ann Trambaugh not long ago. She's outstanding as well. That's going to be a great night. November 22nd, it's a Friday, at Johnny Brenda's. Get your tickets. That's going to be a great, great show. What better way to show togetherness in a sort of a gathering of cathartic rage and joy? I think those two things go together in more ways than maybe we think. But it's going to be a great show, so try and make it out for that. But definitely check out the record, The End. It's also a cathartic mixture of rage and joy. So get your hands on that record as well. So we're going to do it. Wow, what a long intro, Dan. Let's get into it. My conversation with Chelsea Mitchell and also Josh Matches of the band Dirty Dollhouse here on 25 O'Clock. I'm always surprised with tequila because it gets such a reputation for the party drink and all that. You just slam it back or mix it with something super sweet. And then, of course, I've had, you know, friends in the restaurant profession, you know, that like turned me on to like no, this stuff's got like depth and body like whiskey. And I was like, once someone turned me on to that, I'm like, great, I wish I didn't know this.
Right.
Oh no, you've made it so much more delicious.
I need another vice, like I need a hole in the head. Well, I'm glad we could make this happen. I was super on the fence on Wednesday, and if you had been gung ho, then I would have done it. Is going to say, I would have done it in support of you. Would have been like,
well, solidarity.
If she needs this, then I'm there. Like, whatever, like, it'll distract me too. And then I like how, like, at first we're like, yeah, let's do it. And like 45 minutes later, just like, no, fuck this.
No, I can't. Yeah,
I needed this, but nobody asked me. So.
No, I was just, I think I was just walking through a fog.
I got to work and I looked around and like hugged four people and I was just like, I want to go back to bed.
Yeah.
It was funny. One of the bakers at the place I work with, as I hugged her, I said like, didn't I do this exact same thing with you 8 years ago? And she goes, yes, you did. You came in and I started crying and you hugged me. I go, no offense. I said, I don't ever want to do this again.
Yeah.
I was like, I'll hug you anytime you want, but like not like this.
Right.
Nah, I needed the space. I needed a few days to... But I totally got your point. You're just like, why did I talk about my record? And there's this part of me, I was just like, I don't know. I think it's more important than ever that we talk about things that we do.
No, you're so right. Yeah. You're so right. That was the wrong way for me to frame it.
No, you were not wrong. In that moment, you're just like, I can't think of, I'd rather, like, why would I think of myself right now?
But to be fair, it is an album about the apocalypse.
Yes, it is. Like about an actual apocalypse.
About an actual apocalypse, an emotional apocalypse, metaphorical apocalypse. There was a lot to unpack there, and I recorded it all in a time where I didn't realize how deep the meanings of each thing went. It was almost like painting, like if you ask somebody who'd been through something to just paint a picture, and they're just painting it. Painting. They're going through the motions and the mechanics of doing what they know how to do, which is paint.
Yeah.
And then, you know, they finally get 5 minutes to step back and look at the painting, and then they break down crying.
Yeah. That's how it felt. Oh God.
Yeah. That's how making the album felt. It's like work.
Yeah.
Rihanna.
Yeah.
And then to finally hear the finished project, even most recently. I did it all and then kind of avoided listening to it because my ears were so tired of it in the mixing process. But when it came out digitally and I actually just put it on in my car as if I were a listener who just, you know, tuned into Apple Music or Spotify or whatever, I just started crying. And it's one of those slow release catharsis moments.
I listened to it while I was doing things and then I threw it on my headphones on a hike at some point, and I was like, oh, it's a whole different record. Like, it's a different record when it's closer to your ears. I had it on the car on the way up, and I was sitting stuck in traffic on 95 for an accident, just listening to the record. I go, well, it works for here, too.
Yeah. I think it's not a... And I love background music. I love things that you can put on because you're so comfortable with them and it doesn't require you to pay that close attention.
Yeah.
Anything can be background music. But when I listen to this album and I think, well, maybe this is one you have to sit with by yourself at first anyway. I think there's ugly emotions in it. I think there's like raw stuff. There's vulnerable stuff, and I hope it's comfort to people. I hope it gives them their own moment of zen and self-examination, or maybe they just, you know, put it on to vacuum, put it on to do the dishes, whatever.
Yeah, no, it's you could put on, there are worse things one could put on.
Right.
One time I put on O Fortuna on the jukebox at a dive bar, and they turned it off immediately.
Yeah. To which you want to ask them, like, you put it in there.
Yeah.
It's like that scene in Talladega Nights where he plays the Miles Davis, and they're just like, he's like, But it's in your jukebox.
Yeah.
And he's like, we use it to profile people. Like, went to high school in the 90s, and there was Fish's Alive One in there, disc two, with a 35-minute tweezer on it, and we used to put it on all the time. One, because we liked it, and two, because we knew no one else did.
Yeah. Yes.
Yeah. Perfect.
But I want to go back with you a little bit, Chelsea. Where are you from? Are you from around here originally?
Yes. We are recording this in my shop right now, which is very close to where I live, and...
this is where you grew up?
I grew up here. Yeah, Newtown, Pennsylvania.
A stone's throw away, for those not familiar, Tyler Creek. Was it just Tyler State Park?
Tyler State Park,
which
yes.
I got to know a lot of in the pandemic.
It's a treasure of the Commonwealth. I'll say that. You can quote me.
That's wonderful.
A jewel in our crown.
Agreed.
Yes. I met many a hike around the circuit of there during the year 2020. Which is why when I was driving up here, I was like, oh, I know exactly where I am.
Mm-hmm.
Like, because then we used to come through town because your liquor store was open. we could continue the other age-old pandemic tradition, which is spend time outside and then drink.
Right. Drink outside.
All of the above.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What was growing up around here? Like, do you come from a musical family, music in the home, things like that?
Other than my dad, like, I would say that there's definitely musical talent in the family tree. Not necessarily like anybody was a professional, but my dad cared very much about music, and he had kind of a beloved old Univox guitar, and he would just rip solos on it, just randomly, like, decide that he wanted to play... like a solo from an old Fleetwood Mac album, and he would focus and like hyper focus on that and get it just note perfect every time, because he'd been playing the same solos for 40 years and just practicing them every night.
Oh, interesting.
I think kids have fidget spinners, and my dad had his guitar.
Hey, I mean,
and guitar solos.
Yeah. What did your dad do, like, for a living?
He was a real estate appraiser.
Okay.
So he worked in real estate for a while. And
walked around, decided how much stuff was worth, and went home and ripped. Like,
and just ripped solos.
My mom also was a real estate appraiser.
Really?
But could never rip a solo.
Right. Yeah. Well, not all of us have.
We all rip a solo. in your own way.
Right. If I could rip a philosophical solo real quick. No. I think I was always surrounded by a love for music because of him. Maybe not people pushing me to be a great violinist or whatever, but definitely he took a great interest in making sure that I had a well-rounded rock and roll education.
Yeah. So a lot of records in the house and music.
A lot of records in the house, always music in the car. And because he was a real estate appraiser, he drove around
a
lot.
Yeah.
And I was with him most of the time. He was driving me places, and we'd just listen to the radio together. And my favorite thing in my memories of him now is that something that was so new to me and so tired to him, he would let me have it. Like when Yesterday came on, the Beatles Yesterday came on, and be like, oh, Dad, leave it. I love this song. And you know this man is so tired of this song. And he'd be like, okay.
Let her have it.
Okay.
Most recorded song of all time.
Yeah. Like
he loved the Beatles, but like of all the Beatles songs, it's like,
oh no,
man.
I'm with him on that. I was in a Beatles tribute band for a while too. And if you want to not ruin, but if you want to highly complicate your love of something, go obsess over it.
Yeah.
And then come out the other side.
Yes.
And see how you feel about it.
That's why I quit music school, my friend.
Oh, yes. That's why I never went. Also because I wasn't good enough.
Come on.
Quote unquote, good enough.
Well.
Yeah. So did you actually, you mentioned violin. Did you play violin growing up?
There was a brief, like, handful of weeks that I think in third grade that I tried violin. And the fools in elementary school introducing these poor children to stringed instruments first.
Mm-hmm. Especially upper string instruments.
Right. So that we could all just sound like five feral cats in a bag, just like, and I gave that up pretty quick for everyone's ears. Maybe if I stuck with it, maybe my life would have been so different.
Yeah.
But here we are.
Where did the guitar come in? I mean, obviously your dad had one. He was ripping solos.
He got me one, I believe it was my 14th or 15th birthday. That was my birthday present.
It's around when I got mine, too.
Yeah. And I got a stack of Joni Mitchell CDs.
There you go. Here's a guitar, and here's music you will never figure out how to play.
Yeah. Well, I have tried her open tunings. I have. And I actually was really fortunate to be a part of two Last Waltz events in Philly.
Those World Cafe Live events. Yeah.
With, gosh, now I'm not remembering. I guess Andrew Lipke is really like the point guy for all the other musicians. I can't think of the organization right now, but it's for charity typically.
Yeah.
And I got to do Coyote twice, which was, you know, getting to cosplay as my hero.
How about you, Josh? Are you from around here?
I grew up in D.C., but I've lived here like in the Philadelphia, you know, region most of my life. I now live in New Jersey, so I guess I'm a citizen of 95.
Tri-state citizen.
A child of 95.
we're all children of I-95 one way or the other. And then what was your sitch growing up, like music and all that?
I started pretty young. I started on piano at 7. Around maybe 9 or 10, thought that I didn't like piano, but it turned out I didn't like my teacher, who smelled like cigarettes and picked his nose and then touched the piano.
That'll do it.
Yeah. So my mom took a real estate appraising job next door to a music store that had lessons and was like, oh, do you want to learn guitar? And then
it was all over.
Yeah, it was all... Well, and then I realized everyone was playing guitar, and I saw on MTV every band had a bass player, and I was like, oh, all these guitar players are going to need a bass player. And then it was all over.
Yeah. No, that's funny. I was... When I was a teenager, I became the reluctant bass player, because I was like, yeah, okay, fine. It's like, well, if I don't do this, the band's over. So,
right.
And then I think it took until I was in my 30s for me to realize, like, oh, I think I've actually figured out what to do with this thing.
Yeah.
My friend Brian Erickson up in Asbury Park, he says there's bass players and bassists. And he says, I'm like, he's like, you can be a bass player. He's like, but you want to hire a bassist.
Right.
Which I never thought about the differentiation on that. I go, oh, yeah. I said, one is just a guitar player that you've handed another instrument to. And be like, well, this tracks with what limited musical knowledge I already have. Mm-hmm. So, yeah.
Well, I actually hired him as a bassist because I was hoping to hook a big mouth bass.
And when that didn't work, you're just like,
Much to my chagrin, this guy showed up with his bass. Yeah. She also
got a lot of bass, but, you know, more bass than bass these days.
And then growing up for you too, Chelsea, because I know just listening to your lyrics and all that, and just you own a bookstore, and books and literature are obviously a big part of your life too. I imagine poetry and things like that were a big part of you growing up.
Yes. I started writing little poems probably second or third grade because it was just fun for me. I'm definitely a lifelong nerd and like grammar nerd, vocabulary nerd. I love finding like the different roots of words. I love connecting them between languages, and it's always been fascinating to me. So when somebody said, like, hey, your little third grade project is to go make the most clever rhymes you can think of, I was like, yes!
I already do this.
I'm gonna own this. It was just always fun for me. And then we had a really old upright piano in my house. For some reason, no one in the house played piano.
No, that's like the last generation. Like, our parents' generation is like the last generation of piano still being a piece of furniture.
Yeah. Well, it's there in case anybody wants to play us a tune.
Someone comes over.
Yeah.
The town pianist.
Exactly. Or just whoever's at the dinner party.
Yeah.
It's definitely a generational thing. You're right.
And then when you went to school for music, you went for voice, right?
I did.
For opera
and to study music education. My original plan for most of my life was to be an English teacher. And then my parents for, you know, for better or worse, believed in me so much. And they were like, you know what you should do so you can study music to further your music career and, you know, get a degree. Just trying to take with two hands here, with both hands. They said, why don't you be a music teacher? And unfortunately, it really ruined music for me because I never thought of it in that mathematical way. To put it into, and I totally get it, and I so respect it, and it's not that I don't know any music theory, I do, but it was just not my world to think of music that way, and I was way more interested in writing songs than to try to explain to somebody how to write a song. Yeah. I don't think I can do that. It's not a part of me that I'm even consciously thinking of sometimes. It's just what comes out.
Yeah.
So to like be put in a classroom setting and be like, well, you're going to have to know how to, you know, sight read these, whatever. And I'm like, I just don't want to. I don't have the passion for it. It freaks me out. It gives me anxiety. I'd much rather analyze Shakespeare's entire body of work than do one more day of this. So I did some years of music schooling, and then I got my degree in English.
Yeah, that's fine too. I have an undergrad in English, and then a culinary degree, because you know, why not?
I finished music school, and I wish I made your decision.
What did you go for? Did you go
for bass?
Upright, yeah. That's, I mean, it's very specific, but also like there's only so many upright bass gigs.
Well, God, we just did a gig the other day in Doylestown. It was this outdoor gig, and he sandwiched our Dirty Dollhouse show between two other gigs because, A, he's a fantastic player and everybody is, you know, hoping to get a slice of matches.
Gotcha.
But, like, B, you're right. That is a more rare skill set. Yeah. And to have gone through, he went to Temple. I'm going to tell him about your life if you don't mind. He went to Temple and, you know, completed the hell out of that program and is kind of a jack of all trades when it comes to musical styles. Like, he can do, if I want to sing something country, if I want to do something jazzy, if I want to do something rockabilly, if I want to do just, like, it's lo-fi indie rock, he's ready.
Yeah.
And to have a versatile player in your band is, like, priceless.
Especially on the low end too, which most, to the passing listener, they wouldn't think that that was important, but it absolutely is. Because myself as a bass player, not a bassist, but a bass player, I always found my role to be, I'm like, you're basically the liaison between the melody and the rhythm.
Yep.
You have to plant your feet in both camps, but you can't, I think I said once, I'm like, you can't side with one too much.
Because
once
you
do, then you're not paying attention to the other thing.
Yeah.
I mean, and speaking of the Beatles, you think about someone like Paul McCartney or something like that. It's just insanely melodic and also incredibly rhythmic at the same time. And those people, players, are like, they're one in a million.
Yep.
So when you can do that and be versatile and...
Yeah.
Because people are just like, well, it's just all low notes. I'm like, sort of. But then... So you're always writing songs, like even when you were a young person.
Yes.
I mean, poems and songs, and
yes,
it all kind of just went together.
Yeah, it just kind of came together at some point because I was definitely too shy to just start like singing in front of people or to like seek out solos or whatever. So it was like my own little thing that I did, my own little secret. If there was no one around the upright piano, if everybody else was upstairs, I might like mess around with it and try to come up with the notes to the melody I was thinking. But it really all kind of gelled in my church. I spent a good deal of time in church as a young person, and I ended up getting free voice lessons from an international opera singer there, who was my choir director. I ended up being in the contemporary worship band for like over 7 years. Mm-hmm. And those chords to those songs, we were supposed to be helping people, you know, like sing worship songs. And the simpler, the better. So that they weren't complicated songs, and they were easy for me to learn on guitar.
Yeah.
They were just easy for me to, like, play over and over, simple choruses, simple words, and that's how I learned the chords on guitar, is these really simple church worship songs. Now, the church is not really a part of my life anymore, but I am incredibly grateful for... I actually got to be in a band with the music director in one of the Central Bucks schools, an incredibly talented guy. There was another music teacher in our band. I got schooled in music before I went to music school from my dad, from these, you know, wonderful people I met at church, from this woman who gave me free classical voice lessons. Like, I don't know how many other slaps the universe can give you in the face before you say, hey, hey, people believe in you. People believe in you. They want to help you. They see something. So no matter how shy you are, at a certain point, you got to be like, well, I guess I'll give it a shot.
Yeah. And I can speak to that too, just like coming up in church where it's not part of my life anymore either. But yeah, music was huge with it. And yeah, those are the parts when I do it's so. And anyone tries to, like, you know, in general, like talk, like, you know, just talk about church or whatever, I'm just like, yeah, but if I didn't, I'm with you. I'm like, if I didn't have that, if I didn't, and also, like, it was me, like, we were like hanging out like in the multipurpose room downstairs, like teaching each other Green Day songs. So like,
right.
You know,
it's not like we all went to church and just talked about God.
No,
like,
no.
I met some really wonderful, like, kids my age,
yeah,
back when we were all getting our driver's licenses, we'd go to the beach together, we'd go to Applebee's together, we did all these, like, rites of passage together, like, yeah. I went, and they were from different schools because my church is outside of the school district that I grew up in, so I got to, like, meet kids from a totally different school, go to their school dances, like, just be kind of,
get out of your, like, kind of central community
right there. Just to get out of the, you know, this beautiful town, a new town that I've been in my entire life, but just to, like, you know, meet some other people. What I hope everyone can remember, even in, like, dark times when it feels like fundamental Christianity is trying to strangle you, is that it's not all like that.
Yeah.
I had some of the best people I've ever met, I met at my church.
Oh, yeah. Some of the best punks that I ever met, we all met in youth group.
Yeah.
I definitely hear you on that, where you can look back at, you know, a supposedly religious upbringing, be like, it's not black and white here. There's something to be got from that.
Yeah.
I feel like Jesus probably would have found something good in those CDs too. So,
yeah.
You know.
I think Jesus would have rocked a bad religion. Like, I think he would have thought, even like, ah, I dig these guys. Yeah.
No. Hot take. I think Jesus was a cassette guy. I think they were small enough that, you know, audio quality, I think, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
A Walkman, for sure.
Oh, I mean, they were around a lot. Like, he was moving around a lot, so you can't, like, a record player, that's not going to work.
Mm-hmm. CDs skip when you walk, so,
yeah.
You know.
Yeah, back then, mm-hmm. In ancient Sumeria. And then when did the first incarnations of Dirty Dollhouse start? Because I know in its origin, there were three of you all singing together, and that was kind of the beginning of what the band was. You, it was... I wrote it down. You, Amber Twait, who I knew back in the day, and Vanessa Winters.
Yeah.
How did that kind of start?
I just kind of met them at separate events in the Philadelphia folk rock scene. There was like a pretty tight group of us that were all the same age and coming up at the same time and playing, I wouldn't say exactly the same music, but like music that gelled well together. Toy Soldiers, TJ Kong and the Atomic Bomb, Levy Drivers.
I've played that bill.
Like, yeah, the Lawsuits.
Yep. All these people, members of all these bands have been on the show. And I just saw Josh and Ron in the parking lot. I saw them play too at Armour Music Hall for
Great.
For Philly Music Fest, backing up Santa Chiara. And I played many. I was in a band called The Way Home.
Okay.
And I played many a show with Lovey Drivers, and many a show with TJ and Toy mm-hmm. Soldiers and all that. So yeah, there was very much like, we're thinking like it's like 08, 09
right.
kind of period in. Mm-hmm. So we're all kind of playing the same open mics.
Fergie's was a big place to hang out.
Fergie's, you go to the World Cafe one because they used to do it every week.
I did the World Cafe open mic from like 17, 18, 19, 20. I was there every single Monday.
Yeah.
I was there every single Monday. Shout out Bruce Torres. He always believed in me, even when I did like the worst ever that I've ever done in front of people, because I would get so nervous if it was a busy night and it was my turn to get up. But he was always like, really like how that song's coming along. Thank you, Bruce. I was such a nervous child.
And we used to play Triumph a lot in Old City when they were like that place. Oh my gosh.
That place,
not only was it a cool spot, it was in a place where a lot of people would just show up regardless whether they heard of you or not. And like, we got paid.
Yeah.
Like
guaranteed money for a guaranteed crowd.
Yep. Because they charged, what was it? It was some like incredibly small amount of money on the door. Like it was like $4 or something like that. And then they took all, obviously they made all the money, people coming and eating and drinking. And at the end of the night, they would just hand you cash and a little sheet that like broke down, like how much money you had and all that. And it's always a thrill to like, if you put the night together, if you were like kind of took point to like, nothing made me happier than like handing cash to another musician.
Yeah.
And them looking to be like, oh, I go, yeah, I know, right?
Right. Instead of, here's your two drink tickets for PBR or the shittiest well whiskey you've ever had in your life.
Yeah. Bully Hill wine.
full disclosure, I was in TJ Kong and the Atomic Bomb.
Oh, cool.
AM, I don't know.
Did it ever stop?
Yeah, technically never stopped. But my brother met his wife at a TJ Kong and the Atomic Bomb and Toy Soldiers bill at Triumph.
Was it the night before Thanksgiving?
It was the night before
Thanksgiving. I played that show.
Oh my God.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
That's great.
That was an amazing, like you couldn't move.
Yeah.
Because again, night before Thanksgiving, it was a, and you know, we're all old now, so we can like wax, but like, yeah, you used to go out. But like there was a thing, like Old City had a vibe.
There was a vibe. I missed the vibe.
Yeah. South Street had a vibe. Yeah. Like, and you didn't, it wasn't like before. Like before our time, because I've talked to people who are older than us, talked to people like Brian McTeer and stuff like that, where he said like, back in the 90s, you had to pick your team. Like, were you a Dobbs band or a Kyber band?
Right.
You know, and if you picked one, you couldn't really move between the others.
Right.
And I think in our time, it just didn't matter.
Oh, yeah.
It was just like, where do you want to play? All right, let's play there. Oh, that place is doing it? Let's play upstairs of the Pontiac. Mm-hmm. It was a lot of fun. Or, Lickety Split, they had its own thing. Connie's Rick Rack, that whole...
I played Connie's Rick Rack.
Everyone, because you literally just could show up. But it was something just to have these... And a very low barrier to entry. Like, if you just wanted to do it and someone said, okay.
Well, my place that was that I got to cut my teeth... Just trying to break in. It's tough when you're an anxious person and you've never felt cool your entire life. And you are all of a sudden trying to play in front of other Philly musicians and like try to be accepted or like hope that they don't all go downstairs to the other bar. Like when you start playing, I don't know. Again, I feel like I always am fighting for my space. Just in the music world, like I don't ever feel like that what I do is gonna grab anyone particularly, and I guess that's my journey to be on. But the place that always welcomed me and always believed in me, and the guy that always believed in me from day one, was Derek Dorsey. I just want to shout him out because I think he's such a special person. I think he gave a lot of people their first gigs, and he always had a spot for me at the Fire, no matter what. And he continued to be like that for years.
Yeah.
And There's an organization I'm also going to shout out that benefits him and his long health care journey.
Yeah.
It's called We Live On.
Yeah, I've shelled for it myself.
Yeah, yeah, I've played a couple of those shows, and I just want to tell Derek that Philly remembers. Philly remembers everything you did for that scene and for Girard Avenue. And
absolutely,
we're all rooting for you, bud.
No, and I've said it enough times on this show that people who listen enough can probably repeat along. He gave so many of us our first crack at doing anything ourselves, and he sort of retreated from that a little bit just because he hasn't really been able to do it. But he seems to be doing a lot better lately.
Yeah.
I've seen him out at shows and. It's like almost like the old days.
Right. But we just want him to be happy.
Yeah. Oh,
I want you to be happy and healthy, bud. And yeah. Your legacy in the Philly scene is monumental. And I just want him to know that.
Well, because he showed us what you needed to do. He didn't hold our hands, but he didn't, you know, he just set expectations. He's like, this is what you got to do to have a successful night.
Mm-hmm.
This is what you got to do to get paid.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do this, then you got what they said you would get.
Yeah.
And that was like not a given.
Yeah.
I played for a lot of people, a lot of promoters back then, and got rooked probably more times than I didn't. But when you played at the Fire, you knew straight.
Yep.
The Fire and the North Star, like you knew.
Yeah.
It was above board. And yeah, and Derek was like, and then he just let us like do weird shit.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. Did not matter
artistic
what
freedom.
Yeah.
Artistic freedom.
He let Jonas Osterley basically run his own Letterman show, like on stage, like once a week or once a month, like a variety show. And it was just wild. And like, I used to go see Cal Muddy and the Fractals and like, and you'd hang out in that back room in the Fire, and it felt like you were like hanging out in like someone's cool basement or something like that. And
One time I played a 35-minute free jazz version of Everybody Dance Now that you could not dance to.
No, nobody can dance. on bass, it doesn't matter.
Yeah.
But in the early days of Dirty Dollhouse, there were the three of you, you're all singing together, and it was sort of, moving into that sort of Americana thing because your voices were all really good together, and it spoke to that certain kind of music. And then as it moved along and people grow up, bands break apart and all that, I do, as I was kind of listening to your catalog throughout the last couple of weeks, and I realized like the jump, like there's a lot of growth up to Queen Coyote, and like if you had stopped at Queen Coyote, I think a lot of us would have been like, well, if you're gonna go with that. But then the jump between Queen Coyote and the end is really remarkable. Not just sonically from a production standpoint, because like technology changes and we all have access to making records different ways. It seems like every other year we can make a record a completely different way. But just like the songwriting and like, I don't know, like it's a grand record, if that makes any sense.
Thank you. Thank you.
I'm curious. I mean, and a lot happened. In between Queen Coyote and the end. To you and to all of us.
Yeah, for sure. Well, I also want to mention my girls, Amber and Vanessa, are two of my very favorite people, two of my very best friends. And if they were around, if they still lived in Pennsylvania, I think, they'd be at every single Dirty Dollhouse show. And I think we're going to get Amber to join us for the album release party at Johnny Brenda's, which is wonderful.
Yeah.
Vanessa's on the other side of the country now, which... it hurts my heart. I miss her so much, but I'm happy that she gets to experience the San Diego perfection every single day.
She could still be at every Dirty Dollhouse show if she really wanted it.
If she wants to hop on her private jet, I suppose she could be at every show. But I guess as much as my music has evolved, I never grew out of that three girl sound that we started with. I never thought I was evolving past it. I had to grow away from it because they were moving away geographically. And that event of like losing them was like it felt catastrophic at the time. And then I met Eric Laurie, my drummer, and the band he had been in forever, which was the Caleb Griffin Band.
Yeah.
That fell apart. Things happen. We were all young. People grow in different ways and move. But essentially, both of our main projects were like in limbo. And like Dirty Dollhouse, as it is now, wouldn't exist if he hadn't have been like, hey, let's just play you and me in my basement.
Yeah.
And we had many hours, just him, the drums and acoustic guitar, just playing. And he's an awesome singer, too. So Dirty Dollhouse was reborn in this way that, okay, we're not this little folk trio like I had imagined us. Maybe we're bigger than that.
Yeah.
Maybe we're a full band. Maybe we're even a second guitarist band.
Oh.
Like, which I, you know, I was, you know, happy just being a trio, whether that was three singers or guitar, bass, drums, whatever. But, you know, then it started, like, Lap Steel was there.
Yeah.
We had John Hildebrand on keys for some songs. It started taking on a bigger life, a bigger presence that maybe my imposter syndrome wouldn't have imagined if we stayed as just this, you know, the three girls singing. And sometimes you question, like, well, does anybody even want to play my songs? Like, would somebody as talented as Matches want to play with me? Or, you know, then I guess you got to get over that at some point.
Always is the answer. Yeah.
I guess after 8 years, I'd say he wants to play with me.
That'd be weird. A weird time for me to be like, I never wanted to play.
By the way, right now, I waited.
Right. The big reveal, the gotcha moment on a podcast in 2024.
Oh, yeah. Oh yeah. We're all about the gotcha moment.
Yeah.
But full of it.
And here's Eric Laurie saying he never wanted to play.
This is your life in the worst way. Yeah.
Surprise.
No, that's horrible. But yeah, just and growing and like working with these people and realizing that, like, because you had a body of work at this point, like there were, you had put out EPs and a record, and like you guys had played around a whole bunch. And to get to that point and other people to come in and be like, yeah, not only do we want to play on it, we've liked it. Like this whole time, which has got to be, you got to stand there and be like, all right, what's the trick? Like,
right.
Because it always seems weird. You're just like, but not me, right?
Yeah. That's something I don't know. I don't know why I can't. You know, I talked about the belief that other people had in me when I was younger. And there's something in some of us, unfortunately, that doesn't accept it until it's like, until somebody grabs our shoulders and shakes us. And I think now, having spent the better part of a decade with Eric and Matches, and now actually an old friend that I met even before those two, Peter Hall.
Yeah.
Pete Hall. I call him PJ. He's a man of many names. But I will refer to him as PJ from here on out. I made Married in the Aviary with PJ back in 2013. Yeah. And we sang some songs together and spent a good deal of time together. And now, like, as if life comes full circle, like, Married in the Aviary was my last project released as Chelsea Mitchell.
Oh.
And now, like, several releases later, PJ is my point guy on The End.
Yeah.
He's the mixer, the engineer, the co-producer. So it was like, it was this cool moment of like, oh, okay, so it's not that I've shed this person I used to be or grown out of something. It's that I've just added more layers. I've just added, like, I've added to who I always was.
Yeah.
It's not that I wasn't worthy of stuff back in 10, 11 years ago. It was like, it was always building to something. You can't have today without yesterday.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, absolutely. And yeah, and the joy of a vibrant music community, which is what we have in Philadelphia,
yeah,
is that a lot of us just, we're in it for the long haul. And like that hall is so much longer than I think any of us, and not in a bad way, just that hall is longer than any of us ever envisioned mm-hmm. that it would be.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, I would say that about myself with the show too. It's like the fact that I've been doing it for 10 years and all that. I was like, if you had asked me when I started, like, it wouldn't have been a yes or no question.
Yeah.
And I think that's true for a lot of bands too. Like when they make their first couple records or they start playing shows, do their first couple tours, and people just being like, how long you think this will go on for? And you're just like, not even qualified to answer that question.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you're just putting your head down and you're just doing the work and like, you know, trying to enjoy it, at least from time to time, you're not really thinking about like, oh, well, what will this mean? You know,
yeah.
I'm the least qualified person to tell you how this is going.
Yeah.
and when I've said that to other artists, they've always been like, oh yeah, no, I get it. and then you bought this place somewhere. You've
yes.
worked here in the bookstore for a long time, right?
This summer is 20 years, so
yeah,
it's a second home. It's a community staple, and I don't say that as though I'm taking credit for it being a community staple because it's been around for 43 years.
Yeah,
I just say that it's a community staple, and that, you know, those CDs I mentioned earlier that my dad gave me, a stack of Joni Mitchell CDs. Guess where he bought them?
From here.
Here.
Yeah.
I opened them years later, like when I started working here, because I didn't start here till 2005, and I had gotten my guitar before that. And I remember opening the CDs after I got the job and being like, oh my God, that's Bobby's handwriting. That's the previous owner of the store, Bobby Lewis. I was like, that's her handwriting. These are her codes. How did I not know that for my whole childhood, you know, my dad was popping into this store and getting me CDs and the books I needed for school.
And it really does speak to the importance of spaces like this everywhere. Like, I mean, here, anytime I come into a town, regardless of size or whatever, I'm always, if there's like one good bookstore and one good record store, I'm like, okay, things seem to be going okay here.
Yeah.
Because I mean, like, aside from, you know, the big box and Amazonification of the whole world, like, I don't know. I often have the, you know, in my more pessimistic moments, I sit there, I'm like, does anyone care about any of this? And then you think about it sometimes when you know, think about events in the world and all that, you'd be like, well, this doesn't even matter compared to, you know, all these other things that could be going on in the world. And then I always have to take a step back and just be like, well, no, it does. And so I'm sure, like, not to keep bringing this back to the election, but like the next day you get up and you open the store because...
Yeah. You open the store.
Whatever that is. Like, whatever that
you
is.
Open
to you.
Your store.
Yeah.
I open my store literally, but whatever opening your store is metaphorically, you just go in and you do that because there is somebody feeling alone that day. There is somebody who absolutely needs to walk around and touch old books.
Yeah.
There is somebody who needs to get an old record that reminds them of somebody that's not here anymore. There's a reason this store has been here for 43 years, and it's not because I have great business prowess. It is not because of my business prowess, I'll tell you that. It's not because the economy's booming, because it's not. It's not because, you know, for whatever reason, like vinyl took off a couple years ago. Because guess what? You can get that vinyl on Amazon.
Yeah.
You can get that vinyl at Urban Outfitters.
Yeah.
But if you want to come here and you want to maybe talk to the person behind the desk for 5 minutes, because maybe it's the only person you speak to the entire day, the only human interaction you have, it's here. And I'm so glad to still be here.
Yeah.
Do I know what the future holds? Do I know if I'm going to be able to pay my bills every month? Honestly, no.
Yeah.
But for as long as I am able to, and for as long as there's like a shy kid like me whose dad may be coming in to get them CDs to encourage them, or vinyl or cassettes. Yes, I still have cassettes. We're going to fucking be open.
Yeah. No, it's true. And it's important. And like in way, I don't know. I think about it more and more as I get older too. And like, aside from just like my tastes and whatever, it's like, oh, I like books. Like I told you in the text, I said, a place full of books and record is both like my favorite place and also one of the more dangerous places that I could be let loose in. When I go on vacation, it's the worst. Like I have to, I buy coffee table books about like reggae record labels and like
try and
shove them back in a suitcase so I can bring
I
them
know.
Home.
But that's the first place I look for when I go to any town.
Yep.
It's home base.
Yeah.
There's the hotel or Airbnb you're staying in.
Yeah.
And then there's home base of being like, where's my coffee shop? Where's my bookstore? Where's my record store?
Yeah.
If you come to Newtown, I got to tell you,
it's all
I have the books and the records.
Yeah, yeah. I also am always looking for them. Like, where's the guitar store? Like,
right.
Chances are, hopefully, they're all on the kind of the same drag. And as I was driving into town too, I also saw. I'm like, oh, and there's the weird like anime and cartoon toy store. I'm like, good, that needs to exist.
Alternate dimension toys.
Yeah,
they're awesome.
Yeah, it's like, but that's for some other kid. Like, that's their thing right mm-hmm. there. Yeah, the fact that those places can still hold on and still be around. Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I mean, who knows what anything looks like, regardless of current events or whatever. Like, who knows what goes forward in the commercial landscape mm-hmm. in this country.
Yeah.
I always hope there's enough room for, like I said, we don't need to rule. None of us trying to rule the world. We're just being like, can we just have our... I always say, I'm like, can I just have my weird thing that no one cares about except for the people that do?
Yeah. Like,
and the work ethic is obviously there because, I mean, aside from making the music and making the records and then running the business as well. And I still love the story that John Batiste told me, which is that 2 days before you got married, you still schlepped down to Philadelphia to do your key session because you're just like, nope, we're doing it.
Right. Right. Yeah. Well, you know, to be fair, I think it was 3 or 4 days.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, no, that's tons of time.
Tons more time.
And also, to be fair, we were supposed to do it months before. But right. John Batiste was like, I want to make you work for it.
Yeah, yeah. We had so much fun doing that key session. And another person, if I'm going to shout out Derek Dorsey, then I also got to shout out John Batiste.
Yeah.
He has been on Team Dirty Dollhouse since we did... a weird show inside, like, I can't remember exactly what it was, but it was a very non-traditional venue.
Yeah.
Something to do with airplanes or, it was just this bizarre location. And we played there, and all of a sudden, like, the guy, the DJ from my favorite radio station is sitting in the audience watching me and feeling like the fraud that I am. I'm like, I bet he's here because, you know, Vanessa and Amber are in the band. And they're in bands that are bigger than this band. And, and that's probably why he's here. And he's just been on our side for all these years, like following along and sharing our songs. And I've been blessed my whole life with people who believe in me. I really have. I hope anyone who's passionate about something and tries really hard like gets to feel that too, because it's hard to believe in yourself. It's like that in and of itself is a gift, but like to have others cheer you on is like, wow.
Yeah.
I'm the luckiest.
I came to you guys through Carolyn Lederach. That's how I, because I was, you were part of like a current stable of like bands that she was working with at the time. And I knew her. And in my head, I was just like, well, if Carolyn's getting involved, I'm like, let's see what's going on here. And it's just, it's fun in the community to have those people who like, who get involved and who stand behind things for no other reason than they just, we dig it.
Carolyn's an incredible force.
Oh, my
Carolyn.
Gosh. She's one of my favorite people in Philadelphia, and she would probably scrunch her face up at that if I said that, if she hears this. But like every time I get a chance to sit and basically talk shit with Carolyn is it's my favorite.
Oh, she'll spill the tea.
Oh, she's the best.
She will brew that tea and spill the tea.
Oh my gosh. Like I remember running into her at an event at like Rec Philly or something like that. And she and I just, And we were there to meet people and like talk to people. And she and I were like in a corner for like 20 minutes just being like, did you hear this? Yeah, what about that? Oh my God. Yeah, well, what do you think about that? I don't like that. And it's just like,
yeah.
And I'm like, this is so much fun.
Listen, she's got opinions, but every single one of them is right.
Yes, yes. Yeah, where's the lie?
She's only got facts. She is definitely one of my favorite friends that I've made through the scene. And
same here.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Cheers to Carolyn, yeah. and I thank her so much for setting this up between us, because it's been a delight to talk to you as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So the record's out now. It's everywhere that we can find it. And you've got the show coming up. That's November 22nd, correct?
November 22nd.
I got it right. Oh, my God.
It's the Friday before Thanksgiving, so I don't want to hear any bullshit about your Thanksgiving plans, because it's the next week.
It's not happening yet.
It's just not happening yet. Listen, November 22nd is for you to let loose, scream a little bit. We have some kind of ragey folk songs on this album, like
cathartic builds.
Yeah. So I encourage you to listen to the album several hundred times before November 22nd, learn the lyrics, and come scream with me.
Yeah. Who else is on the bill with you guys?
Dominey and...
Oh my gosh, I haven't seen Dominey in ages.
Well, you're going to see Dominey.
That's fun.
And this girl, Bren.
I've seen Bren. She played with Brittany Ann.
Yes.
And Bren, she was outstanding.
Bren is wonderful. I met her because of your pal, Phil Reese.
Mm-hmm. Because she's from up in the from up in Bethlehem.
At a songwriter's round, she was the person directly next to me, and... I think she saved me from heat stroke.
Good. We're all going to look out for each other.
I was playing in Bethlehem, and it was probably 87 degrees and 100% humidity, and it was like 7:30 at night. So the sun wasn't even like blaring on us. It was just the hottest. Yeah. It was the hottest. And I finished playing my song, and she looked at me kind of like, I'm getting you water. Please don't fall off your stool.
Please don't fall off.
Like... And I couldn't thank her more, because I was fading fast. And not only is she a considerate fellow citizen, but so fucking talented. Yeah. I'm sorry if I'm not allowed to curse on this podcast.
I already did.
I still haven't, for the record.
No.
Well, Josh, you can be the one that does. You can be the one thing that's not like the other.
Listen, Josh never goes blue. He never goes blue.
No, and the other thing I love about Bren from seeing her play is that she's also just so incredibly funny.
Yes.
She's so entertaining on stage.
She's very funny. She's open. She's honest. And those are some of my favorite qualities in people. So. Yeah.
So it's going to be a great show.
Yes.
Are you guys doing anything more after the shows?
2025 is TBD, but of course we want to get out there. Of course we want to do more things. I unfortunately have to turn my gaze right back to the shop after the show, because we've got Record Store Day Black Friday.
Oh,
we've got holiday season, and that's the retail biz, baby.
Yeah, yeah. And a newlywed as well.
And a newlywed, yes.
Yes.
My beloved husband Patrick is super supportive, and
is he a musician as well?
He also is a musician. He's not currently an active musician, lucky for him, because I would rope him into the family band. But he's he's wonderful, and you'll probably hear him cheering the loudest at Johnny Brenda's.
It's good. I found this too. It's good to partner with people who share the enthusiasm and passion for what you do, but not, I always say, I'm like, but you're not damaged by it like I am, which is probably for the best.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I find that in a lot of lines of work too. It's just like, appreciate, understand, but like, you do not have to partake in any of this.
Well, he's in social work.
There you go.
So we've both got our things that are like, hey, I know you know that I'm really stressed about this album release show, and I know he's stressed about everyone in the world. So.
Wow. He'll be at the show. He can scream. He can scream with everyone else.
Mm-hmm.
Well, Chelsea, Josh, thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Well, that's the show for this week. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you, Chelsea Mitchell and Josh Matches of the band Dirty Dollhouse, for sitting, for talking, for sharing incredibly smooth sipping tequila. If I hadn't had to drive all the way back to Philadelphia, I would have enjoyed more of that tequila. But it was great. Great to talk. Loved doing it, just kind of in the openness of the bookstore. It was really fun. And great conversation. And then I will say, we turned the mics off. I packed up. And then we, of course, all sat there for another hour just continuing to talk about life and the week and the future and the past and everything. To use the term therapeutic is somewhat limiting, but it's sure that'll work. It was useful. It was time well spent. So I thank the two of them for that as well, outside of the recorded conversation. Check out the new record from Dirty Dollhouse. It's called The End. It's about the end of the world. Appropriate. Yes, I think so. Always appropriate. That's sort of neat and also unfortunate that an album about the end of the world can be appropriate at pretty much any time. But yes, go check out The End. It's available everywhere you get digital music. Go to dirtydollhousemusic.com and get your tickets for their Johnny Brenda's show November 22nd. It's a Friday night. Johnny Brenda's with Dominie and Bren. It's going to be a great, great show. I will be there. Like Chelsea says, come have a cathartic yell about it. It's going to be a good time. Going to leave you with a song from that record. This is the first the first track off the album. It's called Everything's Fine. I know, right? You start an album about the apocalypse off with a track called Everything's Fine. Great tune. I love the record. I really do. Go check it out. My name is Dan Drago. It's 25 o'clock, Philadelphia's longest running music podcast, I believe. Until next time, take care of yourselves. Enjoy this track from the new Dirty Dollhouse record, The End.
What if I had died right here in my hometown? Can't breathe when he tells me to calm down. I see that he means well, but I doubt he has any idea what I'm feeling now. And the last thing I need is him walking out. So I keep making light of it, blacking out. I drink till all of my nerves drown, drown. So who's gonna save me now? Been losing everyone, now is used to letting down. Everything's fine, I'm having a hard time, a hard time. Everything's fine, I'm sleeping high on.